And with three senators here present, the meeting is now called to order. The chair would like to first of all recognize our colleagues. First, the most senior here and most respected senator coming from the labor sector, Senator Senate President pro tempore, Senator Franklin Drilon. Senator Nancy Binay is also with us, who's also a member of this committee. We'd like to welcome our guests and let me acknowledge our guest this morning, Undersecretary Georgie Aragon of the Department of Labor, OIC USEC Maria Gloria Tango, sorry ma'am, from the Workers' Welfare and Social Protection Cluster, ASEC Catherine Brimon, morning, our good friend, Honorable Chofilo Pilando Jr. of the Professional Regulation Commission, our representative from TESDA, the Deputy Director General, Sir Alvin Feliciano, from the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration, Attorney Robert Chuan, the Chief Legal Staff, Mr. Josefino Torres, the Deputy Administrator, Mr. Alex Avila from the National Wages and Productivity Commission, Ms. Shirley Pascual, Executive Director of the National Conciliation and Mediation Board, and Ma'am Celeste Valderrama of the Institute for Labor Studies. Of course, we'd like to acknowledge Director Romeo Montefalco Jr. of the Legal Service of the Department of Labor. And also, we'd like to recognize the arrival also of one of our members, Senator Risa Ontiveros Barakel. Morning. Again, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Mapagpala po at makasaysayang araw sa ating lahat. I believe that there are several needs that this committee must address. The need to end endo or contractualization of labor, the need to reform our apprenticeship system, the need to solve youth unemployment, the need to ensure mobility of Filipino workers, the need to expand the country's technical vocational education and training, and the need to create decent and productive jobs for our people. As the chair of this committee, I hope to motivate all of you today and address these needs by working openly and listening to the various insights and preferences of the different sectors concerned. I know that this committee has actively worked with you in the 16th Congress, which led to the passage of vital legislative measures such as Republic Act No. 10691, which established a labor market information infrastructure at the grassroots level for a more efficient and effective access to employment through the creation of Public Employment Service Office, or PESO. This 17th Congress, I am confident that we can nurture and deepen this collaboration towards legislative positions that seek to protect our workers from abuse, but also allow for an environment where businesses could flourish and industrial peace maintained. Tamang-tama po ang mandato ng committee na ito para sa trabaho, edukasyon, serbisyo, dignidad at asenso ng bawat manggagawang Pilipino. Mga isyong malapit po sa aking puso at alam kong naging advokasya na rin po ninyo sa loob ng mahabang panahon. President Duterte said that endo is an injustice against our workers that must be stopped. His commitment to end endo spurred the rise in public demand to end unfair labor practices. But this undertaking is not a simple one. As part of the Labor Committee, we are tasked to formulate ways to address the existing loopholes in the labor law. For several years, these loopholes have enabled abusive practices and placed many of our workers in an unfavorable position. At the onset of our consultation with the different groups and experts on the issue, we gathered some initial set of proposals to address this issue. One option is to simplify classification of workers into regular, probationary, and project-based or seasonal. Another proposal is to mandate enterprise-based training that will improve the skills and competencies of workers consistent with the qualifications needed by industry. Another proposal is to include or prohibiting of fixed-term contracts and imposing a cap on the share of contractual workforce. In our midst are several measures that seek to prohibit this endo or labor-only contracting and to strengthen security of tenure of workers in the private sector, authored by several senators like Senators Pimentel, Zubiri, Aquino, Estrada, and Risa Ontiveros is also with us right now. And in line with these proposals, this representation filed resolution number 96, which seeks an inquiry on the extent of contractualization in various industries in the country. I hope that through this preliminary meeting, we can also understand the nature of contractualization. What type of industry is it most common? The sectors affected and how the industries manage to circumvent the law. Our bottom line is to ensure that the welfare of our workers are protected. Makakaasa po kayo na ang committee na ito ay walang ibang gagawin kundi ang makalikha ng mga batas na magpaparami ng trabaho sa bansa, magpapalawak ng mga dekalidad na pagsasanay at edukasyon, maglalaan ng dagdag ng mga serbisyo para sa mga manggagawang Pilipino, mag-aangat ng kanilang dignidad at mga batas na magbibigay daan sa kanilang pag-asenso. Muli, marami pong salamat at magandang umaga. We'd like to ask if there... The chair would like to state for the record the officers and members of this committee. This committee is... The Vice Chair of this committee is Senator Sunny Angara. Members, Senator Bam Aquino, Senator Nancy Binay, Senator Cynthia Villar, Senator Grace Po, Senator J.V. Ejercito, Senator Manny Pacquiao, Senator Loren Legarda, Senator Panfilo Lacson, Senator Risa Ontiveros, Senator Francis Escudero, and Senator Antonio Trillanes. With ex-officio members, Senator Franklin Drilon, Senator Vicente Soto III, and Senator Ralph Recto.
Mr. Chair, yes. I move to adopt the applicable rules of the Senate as well as the applicable rules of procedure governing inquiries in aid of legislation.
There is a motion, duly seconded. The motion by the Honorable Senator, the rules, organization adoption of rules. The motion is carried. We'd like to ask now, if you may. We'd like to ask the Department of Labor and its attached agencies to give their opening statement, or perhaps if I think there's a presentation prepared by the Undersecretary. The Undersecretary of DOLE, Ms. Georgie Aragon, is recognized.
Maraming salamat po, Chairman. Magandang umaga po sa inyo, to the Honorable Chairman of the Committee on Labor, Employment and Human Resources Development, Senator Joel Villanueva, sir, Senator Franklin Drilon, Senator Maria Lourdes Nancy Binay, and Senator Risa Ontiveros Paraquel, magandang umaga po. On behalf of the Acting Secretary Joel Maglungsod, who is right now with the President in Davao, and Secretary Silvestre Bello, who had wanted to personally extend his warm greetings to the committee, but is right now on official mission as lead in the government's efforts under Operation Bring Them Home for Stranded OFWs in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Allow me, Mr. Chair, to convey the department's firm commitment to work closely with the committee in the 17th Congress. It is with a sense of heightened vigor and optimism to know that the committee is led by no other than Senator Villanueva, whose sterling leadership during his term at TESDA has made a difference in public service and has served as a pillar of organizational strength for the Department of Labor as well. Allow us to provide the committee a briefing on the DOLES priorities and thrusts, taking into account the President Rodrigo Duterte's overall directives to the Labor Department to be strictly implementing and enforcing labor laws, rules, and standards, promote and protect workers' rights and welfare, and ensure that prompt and responsive assistance and support is provided to the Filipino workers both here and abroad. Sir, with your permission, it's really a 7-minute presentation.
Please proceed, Yusei Garagot.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The presentation consists of two parts. I will discuss the DOLES organizational profile and the priority programs, projects, and services of the department. The DOLE is the lead national agency mandated to promote gainful employment opportunities to optimize the development and utilization of the country's manpower resources, protect workers, and promote their welfare by providing just and humane working conditions in terms of employment, and maintain industrial peace by promoting harmonious, equitable, and stable employment relations. Its vision is for every Filipino worker to attain full, decent, and productive employment. Mr. Chair, the DOLE continues to sustain its organizational outcomes of enhancing employability of workers and competitiveness of enterprises, sustaining cooperation between labor and employers, and strengthening social protection for vulnerable workers to ensure the workers attain decent and productive work towards achieving the greater goal of inclusive growth and poverty reduction. Organizationally, the DOLE is headed by a secretary assisted by undersecretaries and assistant secretaries. The department has 17 regional offices, 83 field offices, 6 bureaus, 7 services, and 10 attached agencies, and 36 Philippine overseas labor offices. Most of our senior officials are here with us today. Honorable Chair, to carry out the department's mandate, it commits to deliver its services through the following priority programs and projects. Number one, the SPES, or what is called a Special Program for Employment of Students. This program aims to assist the poor but deserving students and out-of-school youth to pursue their education by providing them income through employment. Number two, GIP, or what is called as Government Internship Program, by providing the youth, particularly the poor and indigent, an opportunity to demonstrate their talents and skills in the field of public service. Three, providing labor market information through timely, relevant, and accurate signals on the current labor market, such as in-demand jobs and skills shortages, by developing client-specific labor market information, education, and communication materials. There is the Public Employment Service, or PESO, and the Chair has mentioned that we have empowered and strengthened the PESO in the last Congress. The PESO provides facilitation services such as job search assistance implemented by the DOLE through the network of public employment service offices in all municipalities, cities,
Mr. Chair, with all
yes,
due
respect. Yes, Senator Dilan.
We do appreciate the effort of Undersecretary Aragon to brief us of the organizational setup of the Department of Labor. I think many of us, most of us here, have the working knowledge of the programs, but I think for my part, I would be more interested in the proposals of the Department of Labor on the issue of labor-only contracting and endo issues, rather than I can see from the presentation here that there's quite a number of pages more. Maybe we can just submit this to the members of the committee and let the secretary, assistant secretary, brief us on this issue of end of contract. That is, I think the committee will be more interested in that than going through all of these programs of the Department of Labor. That's my submission, Mr. Chairman.
I think all of us would agree with that suggestion. If you can give us a copy of the presentation and then proceed right away to the main topic that we all wanted to hear, which is the labor contracting and the endo. Thank you.
Salamat po, and we appreciate the advice. Thank you, sir. Allow me to briefly state that to implement the President's directive to afford full protection to contractual workers, the DOLE has been busy in undertaking initiatives to pursue effective implementation of the right to security of tenure, eliminate onerous contracting and subcontracting practices such as the endo and other work arrangements that circumvent the law. At present, sir, we have initiated or we have come up with an overall framework that would guide us relative to these initiatives. And the DOLE reiterates that the use of short-term employment contracts, whether through direct hiring or what is known as bilateral arrangement, by principals, employers, or through contracting out, that is contrary to the provisions under Articles 106 to 109, as amended or in the circumvention of Articles 289 up to 281. The action plan at the administrative level includes a three-pronged approach, Mr. Chair. The first track, by strictly enforcing compliance to labor standards, including existing rules and regulations on contracting and subcontracting arrangements and security of tenure through the labor law compliance system, or what is popularly known as the labor inspectorate system. The second, as initial targets and based on the administrative data of the Bureau of Working Conditions of the DOLE, we will start with as base or universe at this point. We will start with the 5,150 registered contractors and subcontractors estimated to be currently deploying 416,343 workers to some 26,194 principals, and this is the data as of 2016. Some of these registered contractors and subcontractors have been previously subjected to our assessment. Further to this track, Your Honor, the DOLE will assess and reassess establishments in priority sectors that we have identified, such as in hotels, food chains, manufacturing, malls, agricultural plantation, and corporate farms. These are the sectors where the prevalence of endo and illegal forms of contracting have been identified. Also, we will assess and reassess all contractors and subcontractors, as I have mentioned earlier. Third is to consult key industry players in the foregoing sectors to secure their cooperation in eliminating illegal contractual and endo practices. Fourth, provide appropriate assistance to workers affected. So this will constitute as a safety net for displaced workers. Fifth is to prioritize the disposition of all cases involving illegitimate contracting at the NLRC. And the NLRC is with us today. Lastly is to identify and resolve all cases involving contractualization and endo practices within 30 days from submission of the case for resolution. The second track, Mr. Chair, is to review the present Department Order 18-A towards the issuance of a new set of rules implementing Articles 106 to 109 and Articles 293 up to 296. The third track, may I also state that the DOLE will work with the Senate to review the bills filed on ending illegal forms of contractualization, sir. I think we have counted around five bills so far in Senate resolution. To all forms of contractualization and circumvention of the laws, such as endo and the current efforts of the Honorable Committee to amend the Labor Code provisions on contracting, subcontracting, and security of tenure. Thank you, sir. May we also apprise you that Secretary Bello has issued Department Order 162, a series of 2016, suspending registration of new applicants under 18-A and labor Advisory 10, reiterating the prohibition of LOC, or labor-only contracting. We have met with top officials of Ego Zones, malls, food chains, and retailers, and we can probably share with you some of the findings so far arising from these meetings. We have had consultation and dialogue nationwide with registered contractors and subcontractors under 18-A as well, Mr. Chair, and an island-wide capacity building for our labor officials, particularly the inspectorate, or what we call as the LLCS, the Labor Law Compliance Officers, as well as the hearing officers and regional office lawyers. Marami pong salamat, sir.
Thank you, Yusek Aragon. Before we continue, I'd like to put on record that the Commissioner of the National Labor Relations Commission is also here with us, Attorney Isabel Panganiban Ortiguera. Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Georgie, just wanted to just to dispel the fears of small businesses and employers watching and listening to this committee hearing, you are saying na yung globally recognized na contractual work is still legal. Okay po yun. Ang masama ay yung pinag-uusapan natin, yung we're putting our laborers in a precarious working condition. At yun po yung ating tinututukan at hinahanapan ng solusyon. Tama po. With the recognize the former DOLE Secretary and our Senate President Pro Tempore, Senator Franklin Drilon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Undersecretary Aragon, for giving us a preview of what your department is doing insofar as labor-only contracting is concerned. The first question I'll ask is, first, are we all agreed that under PD 442, as amended, labor-only contracting is a prohibited activity and has been prohibited since 1974? Yeah, okay, yeah, please use it. Is that a correct basis?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
So that since 1974, labor-only contracting is prohibited under the law. Is that correct?
Mr. Chair, yes, it is quite clear under
specifically under Article 106 of the Labor Code.
Opo.
Now, my next question is, did you say that you have 5,150 registered contractors?
Mr. Chair, so far as of date, this is the data that we have relative to the registered contractors and subcontractors with the Department of Labor, Mr. Chair.
If you do not issue their licenses, that means they cannot engage in contracting. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
And Under what law is that authorized? If I am a legitimate job contractor, I say I build houses, am I required to register since I could be a job contractor when I build a house for a client?
Mr. Chair, the prohibition, this particular issue is reflected in the department order.
I'm asking you, under what authority are you requiring the registration of contractors? Because labor-only contracting is prohibited. Job contracting is allowed. When you register contractors, that gives them legitimacy. That gives them a sense, a facade of legitimacy, even if they are only, if they are labor-only contracting, and therefore a prohibited activity. Hindi ba? Bakit naman tayo? Okay, so my next question is, under what authority are we requiring the registration of contractors? Because that gives a false sense of legitimacy to the labor-only contractors.
Mr. Chair, the authority is outlined in Department Order 18-A, which provides guidelines as to the legitimate forms of contracting.
I guess, Undersecretary Aragon, my next question is, on what authority did you issue the Department Order 18?
Mr. Chair, it's under Article 5.
What is Article 5?
And under Article 6 of the Labor Code.
Which is,
I will request, with your permission, sir, Mr. Chair, Attorney Bencho, particularly to outline.
Yeah, go ahead. Can
we have someone who can answer the question? Mm-hmm. Please.
I'm just asking what is the basis of the authority for the issuance of this DO 18A, which requires registration of contractors. Because if I am a legitimate job contractor, why should I register? And on the other hand, if I am an illegitimate labor-only contractor, the registration gives me a facade of legitimacy. So I'm asking what is the basis of requiring them to register.
Director Benavides?
Yes, good morning, Mr. Chair, and to the members of this committee. Actually, the basis for the issuance of Department Order 18-A comes from Article 5 of the Labor Code of the Philippines in relation to paragraph 3 of Article 106 of the same Labor Code. And it states that the Secretary of Labor may, by appropriate regulation, issue or prohibit, restrict, or prohibit contracting out of service to protect labor rights of worker established under this code. So it is on this paragraph, Mr. Chair, that that we find basis as to the issuance of DO 18-A.
All right. So there are, on this basis, you said you registered 5,150. Now, did you also say that there are 14,000 plus workers deployed under by this 5,150?
Mr. No? Chair, the estimate right now under the 5,150 registered contractors is estimated at 416.
I'm sorry.
416, po, sir.
413. So that 416. So how many workers are hired on the average by these 5,000 registered contractors, roughly?
Yeah.
About 10? Or less?
More or less.
How many?
Around 10.
Around 10.
Eh, kaya nga naman para lang kakagulo tayo. Sampung labor, these are the little contractors who would have no sufficient capital. That is why you come up with this kind of a situation. You have an average of 10 workers. And obviously, they do not have sufficient capital to undertake labor-only contracting. I'm sorry, to undertake job-only contracting. With just looking at your own data, the conclusion is that there are about 10 workers per registered contractor. If labor-only contracting is prohibited, it is quite obvious that these registered contractors do not have the financial capacity to engage in job-only contracting. Because how much is the average capital of these registered contractors? Kung sa 10 po ang kanilang magagawa na fini-field, eh siguro wala naman silang capital dito eh. Pinapaikot lang ang bayad sa kanila bilang contractor. Yun din ang binibayad parang sahod. Nilalagyan lang ng...
Mr. Chair, with the indulgence of Senator Jones, I would just like to ask, siguro para mas malinaw, yung 5,150 na contractors, they are engaged in what type of business?
Before you answer, I would like to recognize Senator Sani Angara, who's the Vice Chair of this committee, and Senator J.V. Ejercito. Before you answer that question, I also would like to remind the Undersecretary to please provide us, the committee, with all these numbers and information that you made mention, because it was not part of your presentation a while ago. Thank you.
We will do, Mr. Chair. Salamat po. On the disaggregation of the 5,150, may I just call on the bureau that takes care of the data? Is Mr. Curada in? Attorney Curada? Would you kindly give us the disaggregation? With your permission, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Yes, sir. You're recognized.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and the members of the committee. The data disaggregated to the nature of services provided, most of the contractors are providing manpower services, around 168 contractors, followed by security, those engaged in security provision of security services, 91. They're also tracking, hauling, and transport, 76. Janitorial, 52. In the construction industry, 35. Those providing engineering services, 24. Wholesale and retail trade, 12. And other trading activities, also 12. And IT services, 12. All others have numbers less than 10.
Thank you.
Yes,
Now, Senator. Yes, under your Department Order 18A, series of 2011, a requirement of legitimate contracting or subcontracting is that the contractor should have a substantial capital or investment. Tama po ba yun? All right.
Yes, sir.
What is substantial capital or investment?
Mr. Chair, right now under the rules, substantial capital translates to 3 million.
All right. 3 million.
As stated in the Department Order 18-A.
3 million. Can you really state with honesty that the 5,000 plus contractors have a paid up capital or net worth of at least 3 million with 10 employees?
Mr. Chair, yes, because it's a requirement for registration. One of the requirements for registrations is that the applicant should submit proof that the applicant, if a corporation, should have a paid up capital of 3 million pesos.
And if it's a single proprietorship?
Yeah, it must have a net worth of 3 million pesos.
And you're telling me that the 5,100 or so registered contractors with an average employment of 10 workers?
Actually, 81.
Huh?
81.
Huh? What?
Actually, it's 81 The average of 416,343 workers over 5,150. Mr. Chair, is actually 81.
How much? How many?
81.
81. Let's say 80, just to round it off. So, okay. 400. Okay. Sige. So, you're.
It's the 416,000 divided by 5,150, which is 81.
81.
Okay.
So, you're saying that they substantially comply with the capital requirement of 3 million pesos.
Yes, yeah, Mr. Chair.
All right. Now, labor-only contracting would involve performance of activities directly related to the principal business of the client. Now, in where they comply with all the requirements, but the activity performed is part of the regular business of the main client, are they considered labor-only contracting or job contracting? To be more specific, a teller in a bank is supplied by the manpower agency. The manpower agency has sufficient capital. Is that labor-only contracting?
Sir, guided by the parameters under the Labor Code of the Philippines, it's not labor-only contracting because as defined under the law, for one to be considered as labor-only contractor, that contractor must not have substantial capital or investment in the forms of tool, and the workers are performing functions which are usually directly related to the principal.
So I think that is the root cause of all these problems.
Yes.
Because when you when you engage a labor contractor to do the regular jobs of the regular employees, yan po nagkakagulo dahilan sa kailangan ang trabaho sa isang kumpanya. It's a regular job. You contract it out because you're saying this is job contracting even if it is if the activity is directly related to the principal activity. And I am citing the banks, a bank, because when I was Secretary of Labor, I required a bank to absorb 150 workers supplied by a labor contractor who were performing jobs directly related to banking functions. And that is labor-only contracting because the job is related to the principal activity. Yan po ang nagiging problema. Ang sinasabi ko, kung yan po ay related sa principal activity, eh dapat regular employees at kaya nagkakaroon ng endo eh. Yung activity is related to the principal business, they contract it out to a legitimate contractor, pagkatapos, at the end of 5 months, it terminate. Pagkatapos, balik na naman. Because these are regular jobs, regular activities, and they are being contracted out on the interpretation that this is an allowed activity under the law.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
This is the spirit and context of the review of DO18-A. Is the reason why we're in the midst of reviewing it after all the findings are consolidated and have come in, so that we can now clarify and determine what is directly related and peripheral relative to a particular industry.
You said, just to clarify, the results of this review, ay meron na po itong resulta?
We do have a timeline, mm-hmm. Mr. Chair.
What is your timeline?
Mr. Chair, the timeline for the review, for the output of the review of DO18-A is 3 months. So by November, that would be out. But parallel to the review of DO18-A, as the ASEC judge noted a while ago, Mr. Chair, that we are also pursuing the endorsement of a bill that would seek to amend existing provisions of the Labor Code of the Philippines, especially on labor-only contracting.
I'm about to say that, and please give us a copy of the result of this review, and perhaps if you may specify and focus on your policy recommendation that you can provide this committee to help address the issue through legislation.
We will, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I'm interested to know if, and I'd like to hear also from the Bureau of Working Conditions on the preventive aspect of this Labor Justice Administration. We have a representative from the Bureau of Working Conditions.
The head of our Bureau of Workers, Attorney Corrada, is kindly requested to join us. Thank you.
Please. Madami pa ako dito ng upuan sa kanan at gusto ko lang po malaman dun sa Bureau of Working Conditions. Kanina, nabanggit po yung ilang mga issues about this, about our workers being in the precarious working condition. And I'd like to ask the Bureau of Working Conditions as to how do we ensure yung compliance and what would probably be if you have a compliance rate dito sa ginagawa nating mga programa and approaches on addressing this issue, corrective measures probably, and how many workers have benefited in the past.
Yes, Mr. Chair, we implement our preventive approach through our labor loss compliance system. So we have the data from January 1, 2014 to June 30, 2016. Our labor loss compliance officer actually covered around 30,169 contractors deployed in different principals.
30,169
contractors deployed in different principals, Mr. Chair. And for as a snapshot on compliance rate, on minimum wage, it has a compliance rate of at the national level of 82.8%, and on occupational safety and health standard around 64.4%. But we can provide a much detailed data to the committee, should the committee wish to obtain the data from the
yes,
department.
Yes, please. We'll be happy to have a copy of that report. Thank you. For considering that we have the Commissioner of NLRC, considering this particular issue, for example, does NLRC have statistics on the number of this ENDRO or regularization cases filed before it? Although I'm sure na marami sa ating mga workers would have yung agam-agam para mag-file ng complaint against their employers. Gusto ko natin sanang malaman kung ano yung figures dito. Do we actually track what happened dun sa after declaration of regular status? Are the workers absorbed or just paid separation benefits? Ma'am Commissioner.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. I do not have the exact data right now, but we could provide you this afternoon the concrete data on contractualization labor-only contracting, both labor-only contracting and permissible job contracting. We would like to inform this committee that the NLRC is monitoring how its decisions are being complied with, particularly with respect to regularization of workers who have been declared to be employed by labor-only contractors. We also would like to add that in addition to the capitalization requirement or the sufficient investment in forms of tools and equipment, we also take into consideration the nature of the functions being assigned to the contractual workers. If we look at the functions and realize that they are performing core functions, then that's a red flag, because they're not supposed to perform core functions or functions directly related to the main business of the employer. But then if you look at some Supreme Court decisions, even core functions can be contracted out, but only for a limited basis and only to answer genuine exigency of the service. Aside from looking at the nature of the function, we also look into the nature of control that is being exercised by the contractor over the workers supplied to the principal. If we see that the workers supplied by the principal are being directly controlled by the principal, that too is a red flag that there is labor-only contracting happening.
Thank you, Atta. Thank you.
But that view, Attorney Ortigera, appears to be contrary to the view of Director Benavides.
Actually, sir, if you look at Department Order Number 18-A, there is a provision there which states that if a contractual worker is tasked to perform work necessary and desirable to the main business, that's an indicator of labor-only contracting. That's in line with what he said.
No,
also.
The view is that as long as there is sufficient capital, even if the activity is directly related and necessary in the business of the principal employer, that is an allowed labor-only contracting. That's the view expressed here earlier. So,
which is which?
Mr. Chair, I think we need to be clarified on that matter. I stated that by legislative parameters under the Labor Code of the Philippines, we can take as a contractor to be a labor-only contractor when it does not have substantial capital with the conjunction or investment in the form of tools, equipment, machineries, and work premises, among others. And the workers recruited in place are performing functions which are directly related to the principal. That parameters is so restrictive that any situation outside that definition would not fall in the legislative definition of labor-only contract.
Under your interpretation, a bank teller supplied by a labor contractor can be a teller forever so long as the contractor has sufficient capital and does not exercise direct supervision.
Based on the labor advisory just issued, ma'am, sir, it wouldn't fall under letter A, but if the bank exercises control over the teller, then that's another case of labor-only contracting or subcontracting.
Exercising control. Suppose the bank does not exercise control, but communicates with the owner of the contracting firm. Sabi niya, hoy, si Josephine dito, parang absent. Hindi naman niya kinakausap yung ang empleyado, ang manggagawa, kung hindi yung contractor. Ganyan naman nangyayari pang araw-araw. Now, in your theory, that is labor-only contracting, which is allowed because there is sufficient capital and there is no direct control, and therefore they can be labor-only contracting legitimate under your definition forever.
Is it allowed versus
it's not allowed?
No, it's not allowed.
Labor-only contracting in all of its phases is prohibited.
No, labor-only contracting where there is sufficient capital there is no control, is labor-only contracting by your definition allowed? Because the elements of substantial capital and direct control is present.
Yes, sir. That's why the Dole, as its third track, would like to seek amendment of the last paragraph of 106.
Because under your interpretation, a teller of a person performing tellering work in a bank supplied by a contractor with sufficient capital, where the control is exercised through the contractor, is a permissible labor-only contracting, and the employee can be there, can remain as an employee of the contractor.
Sir, unfortunately, guided by the last paragraph of 106, and as interpreted by the Supreme Court in several cases, hindi po siya matatawag na labor-only contracting. That's why our third track is we need to amend the last paragraph of 106.
Sige. I will produce also to you cases of the Supreme Court which says that this is a prohibited labor-only contracting. Because ako mismo ang nag-decide yan eh. Kaya alam ko eh. When I was Secretary of Labor.
So malinaw po yun. Hindi allowed yung ganung klaseng practice. And it's, unfortunately, it's not just being practiced in the banking industry. Kanina nabanggit na sa mga malls, sa mga food chains, etc. At minsan nakakalungkot, pag renew, ililipat lang ng branches o ililipat lang ng lugar, but it's the same job description. Ito po yung hindi dapat natin na palampasin.
Mr. Chair,
Sir,
if I may also add, as we deal with labor-only contracting, let us also not forget that the 555 or Endo practices are also prevalent in bilateral arrangements. So, ito pong labor-only contracting, this exists if the relationship is trilateral.
Merong contractor, may contractor po. Manning agency.
Apo.
Okay. Balikan ko lang ang NLRC. No? Ma'am, please provide us with the copy of that report. Siguro ma'am, pati yung data sa compliance with the immediately executory reinstatement aspect ng labor arbiter's order on cases with claims for regularization. Pero sa experience nyo ba, talagang matatapang ba ang mga manggagawa na dumulog at magreklamo tungkol dito sa mga illegal na gawain ito, considering na at the end of the day, yung trabaho nila is at stake?
I cannot say with certainty if the workers are really that courageous to file a case, realizing that at the end of the day, they would lose their job if they do. But if we look at the number of cases being filed at the NLRC, probably they have this kind of courage already at this point. I am just quite hesitant to cite the figure because it may not be accurate. But do give us up to tomorrow to provide your office with concrete data.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes, you said.
With your permission, perhaps you can also get a sense of complaints on the practice of Endo and contractualization from the NCMB.
That's where I'm going, and I wanted to ask.
The SENA.
If the National Conciliation and Mediation Board is around, maybe we can ask her to comment on this particular issue, especially dun po sa mga na-encounter ninyong regularization in their conciliation work. Paano nyo ba ito hinahandle? At siguro magandang tanong po, ma'am, how many strikes do we have this year? And how many are about regularization of employment? At siguro yung isa pang mahalagang issue dito, yung single entry approach, kung useful po ba ito in resolving the issue.
Magandang umaga po, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. Yes, sir. So we have at present, five handled actual strikes. Two were already settled. But out of these five, two were did not pass the process of the notice of strike, so they are called wildcat strikes. Out of these five strikes, we have four which are based on regularization and contractualization issues. Our basis for determining the issue, the real issue, is with the help of the regional offices of DOLE through their LLCOs. So we ask the help of the LLCOs to determine whether there is really a contractualization issue in these companies. And of course, we continue with the conciliation process between talking with the workers and the management. As to notices of strike, sir, we have, from January, we have 10 cases involving regularization or contractualization, and we also continue conciliating this. And of course, in all these cases, we determine only the genuine, the real issues through the help of the regional office, through their plant visits, or through their joint assessment if there is really contractualization issue in the companies. In our preventive mediation cases, we also have 7 cases involved in regularization and so, contractualization.
Taking it from you, ma'am, talagang prevalent pa rin itong problema. At despite that, even no less than President Duterte said that Endo is an injustice against our workers and must be stopped. Kaya ho, siguro yung tanong talaga natin sa Department of Labor and Employment, yung mga proposals po ninyo, baka po pwedeng bigyan nyo kami ng kopya kung paano natin ito sama-sama tayo na magtulong-tulong na wakasan po ito. And perhaps we can come up with a timeline. Ano ba yung timeline natin dito sa Endo? Can it really be ended by this year? Do we have safety nets or alternative employment plan? In case, no? In case na, as we are anticipating the worst scenario.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Senator JV, Senator is recognized.
I just want to ask, medyo common knowledge naman no, na meron talagang talamak naman talaga yung Endo at labor-only contracting. I just want to ask, Mr. Chair, among the agencies, meron na ba tayo na parusahan sa mga nagpapatupad ng pag minahuli tayong nagpapatupad ng Endo o itong labor-only contracting? Meron na bang napasurasahan? Or if so, meron bang data?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. May I request Attorney Bencio to elaborate, to clarify on the question raised by the Honorable Senator, please?
Sir, labor-only contracting does not have any penal sanction under the law. While it is so prohibited, it does not have any penalty.
The penalty is that you require the principal employer to absorb the agency employees.
That's the most of a penalty.
So perhaps to substantiate the questions raised by Senator JV, meron na ba at ilan na yung na-penalize, so pina-absorb itong mga, at ilan po ito?
Mr. Chair, there we have actually numbers, but I don't have it right now. But we can furnish your office of the numbers of workers regularized as a result of the enforcement of the labor laws compliance system.
Mr. Chair,
yes, Senator.
Wala rin ho yung provision na parang may back pay dun sa mga benefits na they should have gotten.
Mr. Chair.
So regularization lang.
Opo, ma'am. And that's the reason, Mr. Chair, we do take note of some proposed measures here in, contained in the Senate bills on penalties and sanctions and providing even criminal penalties on the matter.
Okay. If,
Sir Chair, probably yes. Itong proseso kung bakit itong mga anti-labor practices ay hindi napipigilan, wala talaga penalty except that they are just required to absorb. Pero kung hindi man, probably we could already study on what sanctions that maybe ang pwede natin ibataw, no? Kung sakali meron na mapapatunayan that violated this.
We'll ask also the Department of Labor to recommend, kasi parang napaka laking injustice naman yun kung ganun lang, and they can probably just establish another business venture tapos practice the same thing. Before we continue, let me acknowledge also Commissioner Shah,
Deputy Administrator
from POEA, Jeriel Domingo. Is here. Deputy Administrator. Thank you. Senator, before I continue my question, I'll give way to our Vice Chair, Senator Sani Angara, to ask questions.
The Chairman, thank you for graciously giving way. I just want to follow up on the data given by the Department a while ago regarding the yung total number of workers na contractual. 416,343, no? Tama? Tapos, there are 5,150 registered contractors. How many principals are there?
Mr. Chair, the record indicates that there are 26,194 principals. This is our 2016 data, Your Honor.
So klaruin lang natin, ito yung nag-hire ng mga contractuals. No? Anong industry yan? Because you broke down the number of contractors per industry with manpower having the biggest share. Sa principals naman natin, sino yung biggest share doon? And how do we break down the numbers?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I will request again Attorney yes. Corada to kindly give us the disaggregation
yes,
on principals, please.
Mr. Chair, the disaggregation by principal is not available at this time, but we can provide your office on the
sige, how soon can you provide it?
Tomorrow, Mr. Chair.
Tomorrow, okay. Any indication? Any without the giving the exact figure, would we, for instance, would it be tourism, would it be hotels, would it be retail, would it be restaurants?
Per our consultation, Mr. Chair, it is we receive information that it is actually the government who actually employs so many contractual
national,
workers.
National
and local government.
National and local.
Master Chair.
Okay. So yung 26,000 kasama dyan ang national and local government?
No, these are just private principals, private enterprises.
So you're, of the 26,194 mentioned by Yusek Joji, hindi kasama dyan ang gobyerno?
No, Mr. Chair, but...
So my question is a follow-up on the figure given. Mm-hmm. Dun sa 26,000 principals, who are the biggest... hirers of contractuals? At what industry is the biggest hirer of contractuals? Yeah, non-government. Because sabi nila, Mr. Chair, the government is not included. So, yung sagot is out of the scope of the data, actually.
Yes, Mr. Chair. Many contractors are deployed in principals engaged in manufacturing, those in hotel, in restaurant, in fast food, and wholesale and retail.
Sige, I'll ask for the breakdown, Mr. Chair, and I'd like to know the 20 biggest per industry. I'd like to know the 20 biggest principals per industry, and I'd also like to know the 20 biggest contractors per industry with respect to the contractors. So we have the data for the contractors and the top 20 per industry, and also the top 20 per principal, and also the top in terms of number of employees.
Mr.
Chairman, may we request that?
Mr. Chair, just to add, siguro, may previous years then, para we can see if there's
a change. Trend,
yeah.
Yeah,
a change.
Yes,
in
definitely.
The
mas maganda yung for the last 5 years, siguro, if that's all right with Senator Binay. So we can really see the trend of hiring and firing and where people are being hired.
Mr. Chair, we will submit as requested and backtrack, on the years that we can provide. the committee. Thank you.
Since you don't have that data, ano naman yung datos ho regarding the biggest hirers relative to the number of regular workers? Kasi that's required to be under 18A, that's supposed to be put in their registration, their application for registration, di ba? So makikita natin doon, sino yung pinakamalaking gumamit ng contractuals relative to their regular workers. Can we get that data? Do you have it?
May we also include that particular data, sir, in the submission that we will do by tomorrow?
Okay.
With the permission of the chair?
Sige.
Thank you very much.
And is there a monitoring of interlocking officers or incorporators or directors of the principal and the contractor? Is that part of the monitoring of the DOLE? I was looking through 18A and there is a mention of labor standards among others, but is there a monitoring of interlocking or related interests, Mr. Chair?
This particular data, Mr. Chair, is supposed to be disclosed at the point of registration. We will, as much as possible, generate this data as it. I share the same thinking that this would be instructive in our review and assessment, Mr. Chair.
Yes, thank you for sharing that that sentiment. But is there any data on that?
Mr. Chair, I am informed that right now.
Is it prohibited, for instance, at the outset?
We have generated that data.
Bawal ba yon?
Walang provision kasi, sir.
Bawal ba yon?
Interlock.
Oh, no, but to have, let's say, interlocking directors. Like, you know, in banks, di ba, you have that concept of interlocking directorates, shareholders, officers. May ganun ba sa ano? Because a company can easily spin off a department and just say, that's the contractor, we're the principal, di ba? We're trying to avoid that kind of relationship, di ba?
Sir, from our discussion here, if it's an in-house agency, then that would not be allowed.
So is there a penalty for that? Or this, again, it's just regularization? Walang penalty?
Yes, sir. That's the end point, which is regularization. Yeah.
So baka tama nga si Senator JV, mahina yung disincentive to engage in this type of behavior. Kasi kung nahuli ka, regularize lang. You comply with the law. Walang, di ba? So susubok ka, di ba? Eh, wala naman palang penalty, di ba? Subok na lang ako. Kung nahuli, edi regularize, sunod sa batas.
Or sana ako magtatayo ng
bago. Or ibahin ko na lang yung mga tao dun sa ahensya, di ba? So maybe, including your recommendation, stronger disincentives to engage in the first instance, ha? Para, kasi kung mahuli nga, parang slap on the wrist lang, di ba? Mr. Chair, may monitoring ba tayo? I assume these are all the, kasi meron kayong requirement to require the principals and the contractors to submit the copies of the contracts, di ba? Has that ever been done? Do you require that?
They're required to submit a copy, Mr. Chair, to the regional office.
How many contracts does the DOLE have on file?
We don't have a number right now, Mr. Chair.
Can you furnish us a copy? Mm-hmm. And how many instances did you require the contracts to be furnished to the department? Do you have average length of contracts? I assume they're all below 6 months, di ba? Kasi contractual to pinag-usapan, di ba? Tama ba?
Mr. Chair,
all below 6 months yan?
No, Mr. Chair. The usual
some are longer than 6 months.
Okay. On the average, about 1 year.
Ah, 1 year. Okay, that's good. So what is the safeguard regarding yung na-mention na ni Senator Drilon kanina na kunyari, before 6 months, you would be replaced and then that position will be filled again. That's the real contracting that we are guarding against, di ba? Meron ba tayong built? Is there anything in 18A? Which would indicate, which would be a, which, parang mahuhuli natin, kasi, kumbaga, ni-replace ulit oh. Meron ba tayong requirement na, do we require the principals to tell us that that position has been filled by a different person, but performing the same duties? Because that's definitely, that is not only an indicator of labor contracting, it is labor contracting. So, what are the indicators, that, or what are the, parang mousetraps that you have set in the law, in the regulations, para mahuli itong ganitong klaseng mga arrangements?
Mr. Chair, right now, that mechanism to detect red flags is not present.
No, Mr. Chairman, it is not present, Senator
Angara, at the point of
because they do not consider certain forms of labor-only contracting as illegal or prohibited. That is why there is no such red flag.
Well, siguro, let's put a real example here, no? Let's say there is a worker who is being hired for 5 months, and then
worker A,
let's say he works in a hotel or a restaurant, and then he is hired for 5 months, and then he is dismissed. And then the same company hires a position to occupy the same position as a waiter in that restaurant, and maybe there is a gap of 1 or 2 or 3 months. Is there anything in 18A which requires us to require the principal na sabihin niya, o nag-hire ulit kami, same position? Kasi that's the essence of contractualization, that is, ayaw ng tao o galit ang tao dahil may position naman ang kumpanya, pero iniikot-ikot lang ang tao, di ba?
And it's the same job description.
Oo, parehong trabaho yun, pero so is there anything in your regulation which would catch that kind of arrangement? Meaning, you require. Diba? Why don't you just require them? Why don't you inform us if you have anything below 6 months? Pag meron kayong contract below 6 months, bigyan nyo kami ng kopya. Tapos, pag nag-hire kayo for the same position, bigyan nyo na rin kami ng kopya. And then, we will penalize anyone who doesn't conform with that requirement. Diba?
There are possibly 2 points where we can detect, Mr. Chair.
Yeah.
I am told that there is a semi-annual report that is required under 18-A. So we can glean through that and find out. Also at the point of inspection, if I may kindly reiterate, then we would be able to detect.
Have you detected anything in the 416 total workers and the 5,000 registered contractors? Meron nun ba tayong kaso na nakahanap tayo ng kumpanya na nagte-terminate before 6 months at fini-fill up yung same position after that? Meron na ba tayong kasong ganun?
Sir, for regularization again, yes. Mr. Alvin, please.
Mr. Chair, we actually have actual cases on those
paano nyo nahuli?
Situations.
How did you catch them?
Through inspection of our labor laws compliance officers, they actually go through the enterprises, inspect records, interview workers, and as from the implementation of the compliance system since 2014, we already have cases, and some of them already executed for execution, and some already have been executed.
So how many cases, sir?
We will furnish you, Mr. Chair, with actual numbers.
Is it more than 10, more than 50, more than 100? Estimate, siguro naman alam natin more or less, di ba?
Mr. Chair.
Just an approximate, though.
Might estimate.
Less than 100? More than 100?
I think more than
More than 100. 100. Involving how many employees? Without naming any people, may big fish bang nahuli dyan? Without naming any companies or...
Maybe there are around... less than 100 enterprises involving over 1,000 workers.
Okay. So you're saying over 1,000 workers were regularized as a consequence?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And how frequent were these inspections that you conducted?
These are targeted inspections because of the limited number of labor inspectors.
So ano yung guidelines nyo for targeting a particular...
There are priority establishment, Mr. Chair, and one of them is the contracting and subcontracting industry.
Okay. What are the priority establishments?
Others are those engaged in hazardous work, in hotels, retail trade, manufacturing are also priority establishments.
Sige, we'll wait for the data and broken down, like if you conducted 100, could you break it down per industry?
Yes,
kung paano nyo ginawa. At ito ba yung, Mr. Chair, yung inspection because is it related to occupational standards or it's a separate investigation or inquiry altogether?
Sir Chair, there are actually three approaches in okay. inspection system. One is joint assessment.
Okay.
It's a tripartite, the workers and the employer's representative are involved in the assessment process. And there's compliance visit that originates from a complaint. And if there's an accident, we conduct occupational safety and health investigation.
Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank
Mr. Chair, siguro to add, ilan ho yung inspection teams nyo?
There, at the national level, there are over 574 compliance officers, labor laws compliance officers, based in the Dole regional offices.
So 500 lahat to yung empleyado nyo na
nationwide
that nag-random check?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Siguro, with the indulgence, siguro yung tuloy lang natin yung example ni Senator Ejercito kanina. Diba, you said, ang penalty lang is for them to be regularized. Paano kung hindi ginawa ng company? What happens to the employees or what happens to the company?
There are actually cases right now that we encountered gaps on how to actually execute. So we will submit actually also, we will include also in our proposal measures to for an effective execution.
I think it will fall under NLRC. Maybe hear from Commissioner Ortigueira.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First, po, I'd like to clarify that it's not only regularization that's the redressive relief or the penalty that's being imposed. Other than regularization, po, the employer would be asked to pay reinstatement wages and wages due to a regular employee. And when we talk about contracting or subcontracting, not paying, it's not really true because some companies can be assessed as much as 5 million. One company was even assessed 20 million pesos because other than absorption to the regular workforce, the aggrieved employee would have to be paid all the benefits that were received by regular employees. And if the company is unionized, meaning it's covered by a collective bargaining agreement, it could even be higher. It could even be higher. And we would provide the committee with data on this matter for information that indeed it can be very expensive to hire using labor only contracting.
Mr. Chair, baka maganda rin kung malaman kung tumutupad ba yung mga companies dun sa mga penalties that you impose or they just close shop and probably open another one.
We will provide the office of Senator Villanueva with the statistics. We have a very, very good enforcement rate with respect to regularization. But the problem sometimes that we encounter is the workers themselves would prefer to be paid separation pay instead of being reinstated or being absorbed into the regular workforce.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Senator Duran?
Yes, Mr. Chair, I would like to provide another perspective to the discussion. And this is the aspect of we are operating in an environment where we have a labor surplus situation. A labor surplus economy, which we have experienced for the last, I don't know how many decades, would, as a consequence, necessitate restrictions and regulation to protect the working man. E kasi inaabuso pag mas marami naghahanap ng trabaho, the law of supply and demand. So that is a perspective which we must also take a good look at. Because as I said, 25 years ago, I already rendered a decision as Secretary of Labor requiring the absorption of contractual employees. But maybe in amending the law, we should strike a balance between our desire to protect our workers and generate employment. Huwag po natin kalimutan na it might result in, you know, so much regulation that people, that companies would resort to mechanization and not hire workers anymore. Yun po ang hindi natin dapat makalimutan, because again, that would work to the disadvantage of our working class. Eh, kung walang trabaho, kahit ano pang gawin natin, at use as you mentioned, pag hindi makaya ng employer, magsasara na lang. Pag nagsara, mas maraming mawala ng trabaho. I am not saying that we should tolerate prohibited labor only contracting. What I'm saying is, let us not overreact. Pag sabihin natin, ipakulong natin lahat yan. Baka bukas, sa takot ng mga kulong, sasanhan na nila. Now, that is what I am putting on the table, because, you know, we should also encourage employment in order that we can balance this, you can encourage the business to hire more regular workers, because in a labor surplus economy, the tendency is to squeeze the labor into very unfavorable terms. So yun lang po, I want to caution, put that caution on record, so that we will not be carried away by, you know, all of this discussion. And I'm just saying that let's balance things properly, because hindi naman po pwedeng, you know, ang pinakamaimportante na kailangan may trabaho ang ating mga manggagawa, baka biglang nawalan dahil sa pag hindi na kaya, mag-mechanize na kami ang employer at magsara. So, yan lang po. By the way, we are discussing here only about contracting out. Ano? Yung mga direct hires, the contractual, yun ba, because that is not part of the discussion?
It's actually bilateral arrangements. The direct hire is part and parcel of the discussion and will form part of the interventions that we will submit as to address the situation, yep. Sir.
So yun lang po sa akin, Mr. Chairman, just to balance things, that we must not forget that while we are operating in a labor surplus economy, these things will happen. And we have been trying to restrict all of these practices since 4 decades ago. Since 1974, for over 40 years after we enacted the labor code with labor-only contracting, nandito pa rin tayo, ito pa rin pinag-uusapan. So something, there must be a different approach to this rather than the continuous regulation and restriction that we impose, because apparently it has not worked for 40 years. I do not know if it will work in the next 4 years. If we are not careful about this thing.
Thank you very much for that words of wisdom. Di pa pala ako pinapanganak issue na to.
Mr. Chair,
yes, we'd like to recognize Senator Binay.
Mr. Chair, baka pwede sa susunod na hearing, let us invite the industries that would be affected by the pending bills para naman siguro to hear the other side as to what Senator Drilon has advised us.
Thank you very much. And again, this is just an organizational meeting, and we intend to invite all the government agencies, DOLE and its attached agencies. That's why we're all here. And again, to remind everyone, especially our people, na this committee is not in any way against employers. This is not an anti-employer hearing. We wanted still to create more jobs, encourage more investors. We are here to look for the best possible solution na maaari nating i-implement para na tukoy mismo itong napakalaking problema na ito. Ngunit ang napakahalagang bagay na ating naistutukan ay yung decent jobs for our workers, na hindi dapat nangyayari, itong mga nangyayari. Kanina nabanggit na ilang beses na prevalent pa rin itong problema ng 555, itong problema ng evils of contractualization. Yung, again, yung globally recognized contractual program ay okay naman. Hindi lang natin tinotolerate ay yung pagdumating na sa mga pagkakataon na narinig natin ilang beses kanina, paulit-ulit na hina-hire, bagamat yung iba lantaran, the same person, the same job description, at the same company. So, ang hirap po nun. Kailangan ayusin mo natin yun. Gusto ko lang yung susugan pa, at bago ko gawin ito, bago ko susugan yung binabanggit ni Senator Drilon tungkol doon sa bilateral, no? I would like to acknowledge the arrival of Senator Mig Subiri, who is also a member of this committee. Gusto ko lang pong tanungin sa ating Department of Labor, kasi this is also an opportunity after Senator Drilon raised the issue. Perhaps on bringing yung proposal po tungkol doon sa, I remember nung nasa Dole family po ako, pinag-uusapan yung enterprise-based training. And perhaps we can mention some of the successes of this proposal. And if there are information na po pwede nyong i-provide sa atin, kasi ho, isa ho ito sa mga bills na aming tinatalakay dito sa committee na ito, maaaring ito'y isang malaking programa ng ating pamahalaan para bigyan solusyon itong lumalalang problema ng 555 and again the evils of contractualization. May I hear your comment from anyone from the Department of Labor?
Sir, we will definitely support any measure on the EBT. Did the chair mention the enterprise-based training as a modality, particularly to address the unemployment among the youth sector and the, you know, mechanism to bridge the youth to regular employment and even entrepreneurship? So we look forward to vetting with you some measures on the EBT, sir, even including the apprenticeship
part of it, bill, is the sir, apprenticeship
that,
program.
Those measures will actually dovetail also with the programs in the Department of Labor, for example, on the Job Start, which Congress, the Senate also put into passed last year.
Yes, again, we'd like to hear all possible solutions concerning this issue. And one last thing before I give the floor to Senator Risa Ontiveros. Yung pong kanina, isa sa mga naging proposals ay yung magkaroon ng simplified classification of employees. If I think right now we have different classifications. No? Hindi ko alam, and I wanted to ask your thoughts on this, especially ang Department of Labor, kung maaaring i-classify na lang simply by saying, ito probationary, after 6 months, regular, kung magtutuloy-tuloy, at meron din naman na yung tinatawag na project-based or perhaps seasonal. Because if I'm, for example, sa isang hotel na nasa Boracay, pagdating ng summer, I'm sure, mas maraming empleyado ang kailangan nila. Hindi naman po pwedeng pag hinayag niya itong mga empleyado na ito, right there and then, gawin niyang regular. So, I wanted to hear your thoughts about this proposal.
Mr. Chair, please allow us to include our proposals on the simplification of the workers that you mentioned, to include that as part of our inputs that we will submit to the Honorable Committee.
Sige po, at ayaw din namin kayong ikahon. Like for instance, in one industry, maaaring baka mas malawak at iba yung classification. So we will give you that leeway. Anyway, we'll give the floor now to Senator Risa Ontiveros Barakel.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and also for allowing me earlier to step out to the Committee on Co-ops chaired by Senator Miggs. And before we step out also to the Committee on Local Governments chaired by Senator Sani, muli po magandang umaga. Mr. Chair, I just wanted to request also for our study in future hearings, the department and attached labor agencies to submit to our committee position papers and policy recommendations on some of the proposed amendments to our labor rules. For example, and these are reflected in several of the bills, lalo na po yung patungkol sa security of tenure, which have been referred to our committee. Proposed amendments, position papers and policy recommendations regarding violation of contracting rules to be made an unfair labor practice, violation of contracting rules to be penalized by fines, employment may be fixed term by the term of the project, task or work, as mentioned by the chairman, a task or work to be performed but may not be bound to a mere reference to a time. The period of probationary employment to be fixed at 6 months, when all the employers shall have enough time to ascertain whether a worker is fit for retention or not, and deliberate misclassification of employees for the purpose of misleading them as to their rights to be deemed also an unfair labor practice. So, Mr. Chairman, these are five out of the possibly more practices that the various security of tenure bills referred to our committee seek to regulate, even to penalize. So I would really appreciate po, as a member of the committee, the DOLES position papers and policy recommendations regarding these. Salamat po, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Ms. Garagon.
Thank you, sir. We take note of the suggestions. Ma'am, we will certainly submit our inputs based on the information. Sir, may we also inform the distinguished committee that the mechanism existing in the Department of Labor together with our tripartite partners, labor and employers, is an institutionalized under the law that you passed also. So we will take advantage of this particular mechanism and for consensus building as well and for vetting so that when we submit to you, then we can have a more holistic approach to our DOLE inputs. Salamat, sir.
Thank you, Yusek Aragon. Before I recognize Senator Mix, I just remember from NLRC, ma'am, I encountered this report a couple of days ago. I think may tokayo, Yusek Joel Maglunsod, made a statement that there's a directive to NLRC to resolve all cases concerning job regularization in 3 months. Is that correct? May I know if this, can you confirm these reports?
I am very sorry. I was not able to read that report, Mr. Chairman. But we would like to assure you that the docket of the NLRC is relatively light right now. We are resolving cases expeditiously. But commitment as to the 3 months, it's a matter that would have to be referred to the Commission and Bank. But we would like to assure this committee that the NLRC is always trying to improve its performance.
Thank you, and we'll be very happy to be of help in any way we can kung may matutulong po kami. Before I continue, I'll give the floor now to Senator Miggs Subiri kahit marami pa akong tanong kasi hindi ako naka-attend kanina sa hearing niya. Kaya kailangan akong magbayad utang. Senator Subiri is now recognized.
Thank you for the delay in your committee, Mr. Chair. I also had to attend to our committee in cooperatives. And we timely because we also discussed labor cooperatives. And, you know, we have problems also with labor cooperatives, with associate members full members of the cooperatives, which I believe when they say associate members, yun na yung endo dun sa labor cooperative, which we should also stop. Because I raise this issue, ma'am, Undersecretary, because our province of Bukidnon and in many areas of Mindanao are agriculture in nature. You know, one reason why many of these agricultural communities are very poor or high incidences of poverty rates is really because of the practice of contractualization. And ang dami-dami talagang gutom, which we know that is the nature of the business. Because, you know, you have, like, for example, sugarcane is 8 to seven to eight months. And then you have corn, which you only, they only work every 3 months and so on and so forth. So my issue that I would like to share with you is many agricultural and businesses, not just in my province, but everywhere around the Philippines, they have the habit of underpaying their workers. And minsan, ang pinapagawa, nagsumbong sa amin, binabayaran lang kami ng 150 pesos a day. And sabi ko, aba, mababa din. Kasi yung agricultural, yung rates sa bukid nun, for example, is about 310 or 320, if I'm not mistaken. Bakit naman kayo pumapayag sa 150? Eh kasi pinapapirma kami ng papel na blanco ng employers. And then what they do is, pag-complain ng mga kanilang tao, nilalagay pala nila dun sa papel, half day ang trabaho at hindi full day. Pag sila naman ay nag-complain, they get kicked out of the plantation or the farms. So maybe you people can look into this. This is actually notorious in a lot of sugar farms, in a lot of big plantations, na pinapapinwa sila mga blankong mga resibo every day for their daily wages. Tapos that gagawin nilang half day yung pirma ng mga tao. I think that should stop. Talagang kawawang-kawawa. Kaya ang daming NPA problems po yung mga probinsya namin dahil talagang wala naman sila matakbuhan. Tinatakbo na lang sila sa bundok at ipinagdalaban nila kanilang makarapatan. So, I hope that the Department of Labor can look into this as well. This is not even endo. This is talagang, how you say, outright illegal activities of rural agricultural enterprises. So this is just food for thought. I also have a bill on endo on the regularization of workers. As chair also of the Committee on Trade and Industry, we had a long discussion yesterday with the federations because in my first hearing I invited the DTI, and the second hearing I invited all the stakeholders. And of course, number one of their concerns really was endo. And in fairness to them, what they were just asking is for a proper description or responsible or proper, how do you say, labeling of what should be a regular worker and what should not be a regular worker, because according to our stakeholders yesterday, many industries like construction and all of that have really a temporary, what you call seasonal, no? It's seasonal, their projects are mostly seasonal. So if also we be able to successfully identify and come up with the proper terminology on what would be, who would remain permanent and who would be allowed to be contractual, and that the contractual employees will also have permanency in their how do you say, organization, whether it's a labor co-op or a service provider. That is what we'd like to know. Para sa ganun ay cuentas claras, and these industries will not be in panic mode, because some of them are actually now in panic mode. We have to balance, no? Although I told them yesterday, sabi ko, pumapayag naman si Pangulong Digong together with Sonny Dominguez na bibigyan kayo ng corporate 25% corporate income tax, babaan ang corporate income tax. So meron tayong give and take. We'll bring down the corporate income tax, but you also have to take care of your workers. It's about time, because kawawang-kawawa talaga ang mga laborers natin. And that is why we don't grow. There's no inclusive growth, because we withhold all these benefits to our laborers. So those are just my sentiments at this point in time, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for the opportunity. But I hope that the USEC can also look into these really illegal activities of undercutting the pay of our agricultural workers.
Thank you, Senator Sibiri. I'd like to put on record also that I share the sentiments of the gentleman from Bukidnon. Na we also filed a bill in addressing this issue in lowering the corporate income tax, and perhaps this is also an incentive again for the employers not to practice this illegal endo or evils of contractualization. Before I go on, I would like to also inform our and remind our good friend from TESDA, the Deputy Director General, of the enterprise-based program. I think they have a lot of success stories about this program, and it's a good way also na matignan natin itong solution na ito. May mga ilang concerns lang po ako kasi hindi ako mapalagay kanina dun sa ni-raise ni Senator Angara. And even during that time when we had our hearing sa committee nila Senator Grace at Senator JV doon sa giving emergency powers, even Secretary Tugade admitted that in his own backyard, maraming JOs and about 10,000 daw, no? Nakakagulat yun na parang, I don't know, kung titignan natin itong ating gobyerno in itself, and perhaps let's ask the Department of Labor about ENDOs, about JOs, what has been done on this concern. As I recall, in I think in a previous year, si Attorney Pilando ay makaka-attest dito, there's a marching order from the Office of the President before on contractuals or job orders in government. May we just know and perhaps give us a bird's eye view of or updates kung ano na ho yung development nito. I'm sure the Department of Labor is working closely with the Civil Service Commission on the job orders, because again, we cannot be effective in addressing private sector violations if we in government is not walking the talk. So maybe,
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Siguro to begin with, magandang malaman, sa dole ho ba inang empleyado yung naka-job order?
Salamat, Mr. Chair, ma'am.
And please, no, this is not just the fault of the national government. I'm sure when you go and look at the LGUs, baka mas marami po yan at malula ho tayong lahat dyan. But what I'm saying is, importante na tignan natin itong issue na ito dahil mahirap impluensyahan ang private sector at sabihin sa kanilang sumunod kayo sa patakaran kung mismo tayo sa gobyerno hindi rin po makasunod. Thank you.
Salamat po, Mr. Chair. Yes, the Department of Labor has its own share of outsourced personnel, sir. The data shows that we have a total of 1,575 outsourced personnel, sir. And these personnel are working in the central office and also in attached agencies. So all told, 1,575. They are performing jobs as janitors, security guards.
Ito parang si Senator Binay lang yung sinagot ninyo. Meron po akong tanong kanina. Can you give us another? Perhaps because of lack of time, because we need to go to another hearing, perhaps we can just ask the Department of Labor, bigyan tayo ng update how you're working with the civil service tungkol dito sa mga job orders na ito. Kasi nung a couple of years ago, I remember may directive na ho dito. And bago tayo magtapos, problema din kasi yung youth unemployment. Can we ask for a data siguro, segregated data on youth unemployment in terms of probably age, how many are not in education, how many are walang employment, or wala rin dun sa training program, kasi ang TESDA, ang dami yung tinitrain yan. And perhaps we can see from there how we are doing, how we are improving on our school-to-work transition. Kanina, bago umalis si Senator Angara, binili niya ho sa akin na ipaalala po sa inyo yung Job Start Program. At masiguro na ito'y wala namang problema. At kung meron pong mga ilang bagay na nais kayong ipatulong sa amin, ready kaming tumulong po dyan.
Sir, on the job start, nagpapasalamat po kami ng malaki because this is a holistic approach to preparing the youth for employment. We are in the process of drafting the IRR, Mr. Chair.
Siguro, i-remind ko lang din po na i-synchronize din po natin ito dito sa anti-drug campaign ng ating Pangulong Duterte. Senator Antiveros.
Salamat, Mr. Chair. Just a brief addition. Dun po sa, ifo-furnish nyo sa committee na numbers of job order personnel sa DOLE and attached agencies. Siguro not just the absolute number, pero they are a percentage of how many, yung total component. Kasi nga po, yung isang layunin ng security of tenure bills na naka-refer dito sa committee namin ay to set a low cap on the irregular or the contractual and to set a high target for regularization. Salamat po, Mr. Chair.
We will do that, Mr. Chair.
Yes, Senator GV.
Before we end lang, it was mentioned earlier by Commissioner Ortigueira that those who are found to violated the labor-only contract are asked, yung sa mga subcontract, mga employees are just asked to pay the back wages, no? And other benefits. So, my question, Mr. Chair, is that would you recommend, Yusek Jojo Argon may answer this, if you would recommend that aside from, napag-usapan kanina na talaga wala palang penalty, the companies are just asked to absorb, no? Would you recommend that if we would put penalties provision if found, no?
Mr. Chair, we will seriously study the particular proposed provision on penalties and criminalization and put that as integral to the inputs that we will submit to the distinguished committee, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Yusek Jojo Aragon, who I worked with during the Kasambahay Law when we passed on there. This presentation would very much appreciate now your inputs because in my proposed measure, in my proposed bill, there's one provision that would put penalty. No, but as mentioned earlier, also by Senator, we have to balance. No, we don't want to be perceived as anti-business. We have to balance everything. So we just wait for that recommendation. Thank you.
Please, Senator Higgs.
Before we go, Ma'am Georgie, you said. How is the Kasambahay Law, by the way? How is the implementation? Because today also we had several hearings on the implementation of previous laws that we passed, and the Kasambahay Law is supposed to help really our Kasambahays. Has it really helped our Kasambahays? I mean, is it being implemented properly? Have they been receiving their SSS and their pag-ibig? May mga PhilHealth ba yung mga yan? Siguro kung tatanungin ko ibang Kasambahay, parang wala pa rin. What can you report to us, ma'am?
Maraming salamat, Mr. Chair. The Kasambahay Law is on its fifth year of implementation. The Department of Labor, through our regional offices, are strictly monitoring the implementation of the law. We have had reports and complaints on, particularly on non-payment of wages, for example. We'd like to recognize this as challenges in the implementation of this very important piece of social legislation. Allow us, sir, to include in our submission specific cases that we have handled and resolved relative to Kasambahay. For example, ang mga cases ng natanggap namin ho, aside from non-payment of wages, some isolated cases on abuse and non-compliance with the contracts. Alam naman ho natin na ngayon ay formalized na ang Kasambahay Law. So allow us, sir, to include this a comprehensive report on the matter.
So just a suggestion that you continue with your information drive because the 5 years ago it was big news, but now nakalimutan na. And again, when I go to particular households of friends, I always make it a point to ask. And it's, oh, kamusta? Meron na ba kayong SSS? Wala pa po eh. Meron na ba kayong mga PhilHealth? Wala pa po. Oh, magkano yung ano? Ganun pa rin po. Wala nang iya. So, without naming names, but really, it's a problem. So, I think an information drive to let them know what their rights are with this new law is very important. Then you'd be surprised, you might hear more complaints. But honestly, I think nakalimutan na yung may batas na ganun. I think we have to start coming up with the info drive, maybe using media, newspaper, well, newspapers hindi binabasa eh, ng mga kasambahay.
LGU din, sir, in ano collaboration with LGUs.
Gagawin LGUs, tsaka yung, sana meron kayong commercial dun sa mga, yung mga drama. Lahat ng kasambahay nanonood ng drama, yung mga probinsyano. Habang walang political ads na yun, baka pwedeng ilabas yung kasambahay.
Importante, sir, niya.
Sponsored daw si Senator Miggs. Anyway, before we adjourn, pwede ba din sa TESDA kay DDG Feliciano to give us a suggestion siguro, yung position paper po ninyo, ano yung maaaring maitutulong ng TESDA dito sa pag-address ng issue ng ENDO and contractualization.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, at sa inyong mga kapwa, Senador. Sa TESDA po, tuloy-tuloy lang po yung sinasagawang training, kagaya po ng nasimulan nyo. At the same time po, nagsimula na rin po kami ng pagkuha ng scholarship sa grassroots sa barangay. When lahat po ng ating barangay captain sa isinulatan po ng TESDA upang sila po ang mag-submit. Doon naman po sa parte ng training, para equip naman po sila, para hindi sila ma-terminate kaagad. Dahil pag ikaw ay equip, skilled, definitely hindi ka tatanggalin kaagad o hindi ka makapapasok sa ENDO.
Tama po yun, DDG, and I think it is important also to look into the enterprise-based training program na baka maaari nating ma-implement dito, ma-implement natin sa mas malawak na programa na hindi lamang nakatutok dun sa techbook. Siyempre, yung kaibigan natin, si Attorney Pilando ng PRC, siguro yung isang question lang, sir, if you have cases regarding professionals experiencing itong ENDO, and perhaps ask you the same thing if what you are doing about it, kasi we're trying to see if ENDO can also be experienced by professionals, no, at hindi lang ito dun exclusive sa non-professionals.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Although the mandate of the PRC is basically on the admission and the practice of the professions, we haven't really gone so much on the business, but surely we'll eventually, I mean, as our capacity would expand, we'll look into that, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And lastly, siguro yung OWA, baka pwedeng makahingi po tayo ng update. Kaya ho tayo wala ang ating sekretary ng DOLE, sekretary ng TESDA, ay lahat ng efforts natin, at natutuwa naman po tayo na ang parehong sekretary natin ay naroon, and everything is being attended to by our labor department. Baka ho po pwedeng makahingi ng konting report or update tungkol po sa nangyayari doon.
We will surely give you the chair and the committee report, a most recent report.
Thank you. Again, thank you sa bawat isa po sa inyo. I think the issue of contractualization, as I have already mentioned, is just one of the pressing labor issues our country faces today. And we also need to discuss a lot of things concerning wages, concerning the improvement of our labor conditions, increasing labor productivity, protecting rights of our workers, and improving access of workers to social protection. I just hope and pray na lahat po tayo magkaroon ng full support and cooperation dito sa mga issues na ito that are within the mandate of this committee, and with the goal of creating an environment where Filipinos will be able to find decent jobs locally, live comfortably with their families, and contribute to the development and growth of our country. Siyempre po, ang prioridad ng committee na ito ay yung sa lalong madaling panahon ay mabigyan natin ng solusyon. Ito pong evils of contractualization, itong ENDO na ito. Let us end ENDO once and for all and give our workers the security of tenure that they deserve. Again, thank you so much, at magandang umaga. The meeting of the Committee on Labor is now adjourned. Thank you.